2012. And since joining the bank, I've worked in many different countries. We are a global team. We are currently working in more than 60 countries across regions. And many times, my clients, my counterparts, competition authorities or regulators ask me, but you know, it's very difficult to put together a good competition authority and that it would work and so on, and we need a lot of time until it works and so on. And I always use the PCC as an example of a young competition authority who can achieve a lot in in relatively few time. This is definitely related with the people who are at the PCC. Not that the people have invited me to the talk, but and it's also related with the way you have handled it, the way you have hiring, the type of commitment, the type of let's say firing the belly, as we say in the bank, of the people who work at the PCC, and everything that you have done even not being able to enforce the competition law properly because the transition period only finished not so long ago. So I do use the Philippines as an example. And the second thing is that, let me reassure you in terms of the magnitude of the participation of the state in the economy here in the Philippines, because my difficult cases are those cases where we have 6,000 state-owned enterprises, 11,000 state-owned enterprises. So yes, I know, I agree with you. There is a large participation of the state in the economy here in the Philippines, but believe me, there are more difficult setups. So I think with this note, let me just talk a little bit about the type of research that we are doing in terms of competitive neutrality in the Philippines. And I'm so glad that I have colleagues from Australia that have been so successful in implementing the competitive neutrality principle. You have achieved so much, and I think this is also, this is the second example we always use all over the world. We talk even too much about Australia. People in the bank have started telling me, stop using Australia as an example, because people feel you just talk about Australia all the time. What do you want? I mean, they have done a great job. So now let's connect these two. Let's connect the experience of Australia in implementing the competitive neutrality principle and as an excellent tool to foster market competition with the regulatory framework of state-owned enterprises in the Philippines. So, if this passes, okay. So, let's start with what it is that a competition policy framework should have in order to be effective. A lot of competition experts even would think the only thing that is relevant is the last column of this tree, which is a good antitrust framework. So we want to be able to prosecute cartels, to punish abuse of dominance. We want to be able to review mergers and make sure that anti-competitive mergers are prohibited, or that the potential anti-competitive effects of mergers are curbed through remedies. And we want to do that through a well-functioning competition authority, a well-functioning commission. And this is very important, of course, but there is just that much that you can achieve if this is all that you have. At the end of the day, you're going to step into the most problematic aspects, which is regulation that results in anti-competitive market outcomes, sector-specific regulation, but also economy-wide regulation, or the participation of the state in the economy through state-owned enterprises that actually is going to be unleveling the playing field for private operators. And it's going to make it so much more difficult for private sector development. And this is absolutely linked with economic growth and international competitiveness. So we cannot look at competition policy in isolation thinking about antitrust. It's tantamount in terms of importance to think about good regulatory environment, an environment that actually enables efficient market outcomes, as much as thinking about leveling the playing field between public and private operators. So, I mean, this is something I added in the last minute, just because you were discussing about the national competition policy. Let me see, this is a visual representation of how these three pillars actually interact when we think about a national competition policy, and I think there Australia has a very useful experience to share. But if we think about the national competition policy, we need to think about the two aspects of how the government participates in the economy, whether it participates directly through state-owned enterprises or it participates indirectly through regulation. But to the left side, everything that is marked in gray, basically how SOEs and PPPs work, how public procurement work, how concessions work, how state support measures work, this is going to be extremely critical to foster a good and effective national competition policy and an effective competition regulatory framework overall. So I don't want to go at length into this, but this is the way the three pillars that I was describing before actually project in an idea of national competition policy, how they interact. But what we see here is that at the end of the day, what we care about is not only the action of the private sector, but the intervention of the government and the conditions created by this government to foster how the private sector is going to behave in the market. So now let's focus on competitive neutrality itself. So first of all, what is competitive neutrality? Competitive neutrality is simply the idea that market players should be able to compete on a level playing field. I mean, let's say, if the government wants to participate in the economy, this is perfectly fine. It's not that competitive neutrality questions the direct participation of the state in the economy. It just puts the idea forward that either we create markets where all market players can interact in a level playing field, or by definition, the market outcomes are going to be distorted. So competitive neutrality is mainly about the potential privileges that the state-owned enterprises enjoy when they participate in the market. But it's not only about that. It's not only about that. Competitive neutrality is also about any other type of distortions. These distortions may be because local companies are actually privileged as opposed to foreign companies, or because even local companies among themselves, there are certain operators that enjoy advantages that other operators do not enjoy. And it's important to think about competitive neutrality not only as a tool to make sure that SOEs and private companies compete on a level playing field, but really as a tool to level the playing field, as a tool to make sure that market operators have equal opportunities. And this is, it's unnecessary to go into why this is fundamental. We all understand what's the reason. So now, the principle is very beautiful, but how do we articulate this principle? How do we land it, as we say in literal translation from Spanish? So let's land the principle of competitive neutrality, and let's understand a little bit how is it implemented overall, but also in the Philippines. So in this graph, you actually see the key elements of an effective competitive neutrality framework. So we have fair level principles, and we have cross-cutting regulatory principles. And I'm going to go into each of these principles one by one. But above all, what we have is what is called the subsidiarity analysis, which to a large extent shapes the participation, shapes the way the government participates in the economy through SOEs. So, let me just, for 1 second, think about how do SOEs intervene in the market. Because this is going to give us a framework to understand the rest of the presentation. We have two axes here. Whether the goods and services provided by the SOE are commercially viable or not, and whether there is a rationale for the government intervention, for the government to limit entry from the private sector. So if you consider these two aspects, you have times where there is no commercial viability, but there is a rationale for intervention, and these are the very big limitations where simply the private sector is excluded for strategic or public policy reasons, and the private sector just cannot participate in those type of markets. But then you have the possibility where there is no commercial viability, and there is no rationale whatsoever for limiting the participation of the state in the economy, yet the private sector is just not going to deliver those goods and services because it doesn't make any sense from a profit-making perspective. So the only way for the private sector to actually deliver those goods and services is if they receive a compensation to deliver non-commercially viable services. And then we have, on the other side of the spectrum, those cases where, yes, there is actually a commercial viability for the particular good and service, and however, the private sector is excluded because of due to market failure, due to other reasons. And then there is a case where you have SOEs, that there is a commercial viability and there is no reason whatsoever to exclude the private sector. And then in those cases, you have SOE competing with the private sector. And now, just intuitively, one would look at this and then you say, why do you even have SOEs in the lower right quadrant? Because if there is no necessity whatsoever for the SOEs, for the government to participate in that particular activities, one could question, actually, is there a role for the SOEs? And I'm going to raise a lot of questions, I'm not going to give a lot of answers, but I want you to think about the answers yourself. So what do we see in the Philippines? So what we see in the Philippines is that actually the Philippines have very little general exclusions. So there are some specific exclusions in the constitution in relation to the fact that the government owns the land and the natural resources, etc. But to the upper left quadrant, there is not a specific limitations in the Philippines. You have, however, certain private sector exclusion in certain markets because obviously there is market failure, such as natural monopolies, and that is also unnecessary to explain. But you have a lot of SOEs that are competing with the private sector in sectors where one really wonders what's the rationale. And maybe there is a perfectly valid rationale, but what we see is that there is, for instance, SOEs in construction, in tourism, in area development, in retail trade, in crop insurance, and why is that, right? So let me show you something else, because we, and that brings me to another big area of research that we are doing together with the PCC. We are doing two things at the moment. We are doing so many things all together, but let me talk about these two. The first is this analysis of how the Philippines actually is implementing the competitive neutrality principle. The other thing, we have actually partnered also with the OECD in order to build product market regulation indicators for the Philippines. So this is this product market regulation indicators for the Philippines, which makes Philippines a very unique country because very few countries have these PMR built. One of the aspects that that reviews is the number of SOEs that exist in selected sectors. And the number of sectors reviewed are 27 sectors. And the Philippines has 18, has presence of state-owned enterprises in 18 out of these 27 sectors. Which is, you know, not that much. I mean, it's above the average, yes, but it is not that much. But then there is something interesting to consider. That is, above all, out of these 27 markets, 12 markets are non-infrastructure. So non-infrastructure markets. Out of these 27 markets that are supervised by the PMR. And the Philippines has an SOE in 10 out of these 12 markets. So that's another piece of information that says, maybe there is a reason why there is a rationale for participation in infrastructure markets. Maybe not, depending, of course, of the sector. But there is a lot of state participation in non-infrastructure markets. So now let's go to the subsidiarity analysis, which was at the top of my figure when I was discussing the framework of an effective competitive neutrality principle. So, the concept of subsidiarity is a very interesting concept that informs what is the role of the state's participation in the economy. So, obviously, the state can participate in the economy as a regulator or as an economic agent. The idea is, why does the state need to bear the costs of participating in the economy through a state-owned enterprise when it can actually shape the market outcomes as a regulator? Yet, sometimes the states decide, no, we want to participate with a state-owned enterprise, and the reasons vary. You can have actually reasons related to the fact that there is an economic regulatory objective. For instance, the state participates in a natural monopoly. There might be actually a distributive or social objective, where the state creates an SOE to achieve universal access or universal service, or to provide certain goods and services to low-income citizens. And there can be even a strategic objective where the state creates an SOE to perform those activities that are for which the private sector is excluded because of strategic reasons, like for instance national security. And okay, that makes sense in our mind. But what is the subsidiarity principle? The subsidiarity principle is the idea that the state should only participate in delivering those goods and services that the private sector cannot deliver itself. Because otherwise, why does the state need to incur the cost of creating an SOE, managing an SOE, and making sure the SOE works properly, when if the private sector can deliver the goods and services, there is no need for that. When the state can participate as a regulator. So that's the idea of the subsidiarity principle. And the subsidiarity principle, by nature, informs the concept of competitive neutrality, because that's the first question. It's like, does the state need to participate at all? And you know, this brings us to a very different perspective than what I was putting before. It's not about infrastructure versus non-infrastructure. It's not about that. It's about, are the citizens going to have access to these goods and services if the state doesn't provide them? Right? And there is the example of Peru. This is a constitutional principle in the case of Peru. And Peru has developed a methodology in analyzing when and when not the subsidiarity principle actually verifies or not. So it's not that simple. I mean, the question we all understand. But you can say, you know, we have only an SOE. How do I evaluate whether the private sector can deliver the same goods and services if we only have one SOE? It's like, how do you know whether there is going to be actually supply for the necessary demand? And there is a particular question to ask. For instance, in the case that you would only have an SOE, one could consider whether there is potential for a private entrant to enter the market and deliver the services. There might be yes, there might be no. If a private entrant would not enter and deliver the services, then there might be a reason actually for the government to be providing those goods and services directly. When we have an SOE plus one single operator, we can question, can that one single operator actually supply the market? Is that possible? Can others join the market? So I'm not going to walk you through all the steps, but let me talk about when you have an SOE plus three or more competitors, when it's really, one needs to understand why do you have this type of setups. Because if you have one SOE plus three competitors, okay, there might be a situation where you need to look into market shares and to the size of the supply, because maybe you have one SOE that is delivering 90% of the goods and services and three competitors that are totally a trivial contribution. But if not, if we have a setup where there is really competition and the SOE is just another of the market players, then there might be a question to say, is the subsidiarity principle being fully implemented? And the subsidiarity principle has been very useful for countries to really look into their direct participation of the state in the economy. This has mainly been enforced in Latin America, but not only in Latin America, and we find it a very good tool to analyze critically whether there is a role for a direct participation of the state in the economy. But it's one of the tools. It's neither the final tool that I want to describe today. So, okay. So you have the subsidiarity principle in the Philippines. The subsidiarity principle is part of the regulatory principle that applies to the SOEs today in the Philippines. Actually, the principle is captured this way in Act of 2011, Section 585. It says, unless there is a greater public interest that may be served, GOCCs shall refrain from engaging in activities adequately serviced by the private sector, or adopt PPP schemes for operating enterprises and for capital undertakings where such approach qualifies under existing laws. The point is, I have 10 minutes. That's amazing. Okay. The point is, you do have the right tools to apply this subsidiarity principle, and even the governance commission of GOCCs has the mandate to enforce it. Because one of the aspects that the governance commission has to do is evaluating whether SOEs are involved in activities that could be carried by the private sector. And if yes, should the SOE be reorganized, merged, streamlined, abolished, or privatized? So you have this, it's part of the regulatory framework, but to some extent it has not been systematically implemented. But there could be, it's definitely part of what could be an analysis from a competitive neutrality perspective. And you even have a particular application in key sectors such as tourism and energy with the case of missionary electrification, where there is a clear role for the public sector to deliver the goods and services that cannot be delivered by the private sector. So this principle is part of the regulatory framework of the Philippines. Now, let me drive you very quickly through each of the aspects of the competitive neutrality framework. The first point is commercial versus non-commercial activities. So the first thing we need to know, if we are thinking, are SOEs competing on equal level with private sector operators, we need to say in which services. Because SOEs typically have both commercial and non-commercial obligations. So we don't care about the non-commercial obligations because we assume that the goods and services provided by the SOE in a non-commercial setup are not going to be competing with private sector operators. But the truth of the matter is you need to be able to differentiate. So in the Philippines, there is not a uniform and clear definition of commercial versus non-commercial activities. Believe me, it would be very helpful. You have this as part of the TPP. You have this as part of the EU laws, where they actually establish that very few of the goods and services provided by the SOEs are actually non-commercial. But you have, nonetheless, some things that can be used as a reference. For instance, the GCG defines commercial or revenue-generating activities. While you have at the sector-specific level some definition of what it is non-commercial. And I think here the Philippines has a fantastic example, which is all the missionary activities. The missionary electrification, the missionary grid, the missionary banking, the postal services, all in the name itself, you see that it implies that it's non-commercial activities. But there is not a clarification between commercial and non-commercial. And that is problematic from the point of view of competitive neutrality because you need to be able to separate the accounts. So those companies that have the differentiation between missionary electrification and general electrification, such as, for instance, in the electric sector, they do have account separation. But those that don't, they don't have account separation because they don't have the necessity to have this account separation. So the definition actually influences whether there is or not account separation. The second part is, are the costs of the non-commercial activity and the commercial activity, are those costs adjudicated to each of the accounts? Well, obviously, in the Philippines, there is a problem because since there is not a clear definition of commercial and non-commercial, there is not a clear obligation to separate the adjudication of costs to the different lines that are provided by the SOEs. So everything is kind of related. But the fact that the costs do not need to be separated by lines does not mean that all those companies that I was mentioning before that are actually doing account separation, they are trying to adjudicate the cost to the different lines. And that is very important because once we achieve this is when we can actually compare whether the private sector is being disadvantaged or not. So the idea would be that for commercial activities, SOEs should not be compensated, meaning it's a question of whether they have a role to participate or not in the market. But if they are participating in commercial activities, that's clearly that there is no way for being compensated for their commercial activities. They should be able to compete with the private sector on a level playing field. But SOEs need to be compensated for the non-commercial activities that they do. So that's why you need the account separation, because you need the compensation versus the non-compensation. So when we look at the Philippines, what we see is that there is no necessity to make this separation. Although some companies do it, it is not it's not generally the case. And the second part would be whether all the costs actually, all the commercial activity, all the costs linked to the commercial activity cover the direct costs as well as an appropriate contribution to the common cost and an adequate return on investment. And there are some SOEs that go and cover in this way. For instance, Philip Health is one of that SOEs that allocates 5% of contributions for administrative costs and 5% of contributions of interest made the present year. The next point is, how do we ensure that the SOEs are actually earning a commercial rate of return? Well, achieving a commercial rate of return is very important because the point is that the transaction then is going to be carried under the same circumstances that the private sector is carrying its own transactions. However, in the Philippines, there is not a general obligation for achieving a commercial rate of return. Instead, there are, nonetheless, some of the SOEs. For instance, the Social Security System Law requires the Commission to invest funds to earn an annual income that should be no less than the average rates of the Treasury bills or any other acceptable market indicators. The point is, what we observe, not only for these aspects, but what we observe across the board for competitive neutrality, is that although there is not generally a general obligation for all SOEs to comply with each of the blocks, you have really good examples at the sector level, at the firm level, for compliance with this. So not only you have the block, but you actually have the internal model that can be followed in order to implement this type of blocks, analytical blocks of the competitive neutrality framework. Then the second part is the public service obligation. So it's very important to understand that the public service obligation, whatever compensation the SOEs are receiving in order to provide the public service obligation, it needs to be transparent, it needs to be accountable, and it should not exceed the actual, the services that they are providing with the addition of a reasonable profit. Because otherwise what we do is that the compensation received by the SOE is actually used to cross-subsidize the commercial activities, and that is a level in the playing field when this SOE competes with the private sector. So what we see is that it's important to consider, although there is the obligation to establish performance agreements of the GOCCs with the Commission of the Governance Commission, every state-owned enterprise establishes its own targets and establishes its own agreement. So there is not like a formalized across the board to make sure that there is actually a compliance with these principles. Tax neutrality. Now, these were the firm level principles. Now, let me go quickly through the cross-cutting principles. Tax neutrality, very obvious. The government can actually privilege the SOEs by granting them tax preferences. And if you grant the tax preference to the SOEs, then you put again the private sector in a position where they cannot compete. What you have is a regulatory framework that actually has said that the SOEs need to be taxed. So the basis is there. Now, what is the problem? That the law number 93 from 86 actually still includes a number of exceptions. And the number of exceptions of the law actually make it more difficult. Also in terms of profit tax, the GOCCs should be taxed, but some are specifically exempted. So again, the principle, good, the number of exemptions make it a little bit more difficult. The other principle is the need to guarantee debt neutrality and control outright subsidies. And here the Philippines has a particular problem, because unlike other countries, for instance, in Europe, but not only Europe, there is not a framework as part of the competition law to assess that the transfers in state aid is not going to have a distortive effect in the market. So the point is that the SOEs might receive, what they receive is it needs to be a financial contribution, it needs to confer a benefit, it needs to be granted on a selective basis, and if all this verifies, there should be accountability for the constitution, because for the competition law, because otherwise what we can do is that the subsidies or other type of benefits, debt neutrality granted to the SOEs can be very distorted. And yes, the SOEs can actually have accesses and can have access to not accessible by the private sector. Another aspect that is absolutely critical is the existence of regulatory neutrality. Regulatory neutrality is also not only economy-wide, but also about the fact that at the sector level, certain SOEs are not getting benefits that the private sector is not getting. And finally, public procurement. Public procurement is also an important aspect because SOEs can enter in what is called agency-to-agency contracts. And the agency-to-agency contracts are the type of contracts that are less accountable and less transparent than the general public procurement means, and it can create distortion. However, once again, the type of distortions that we care about are not only distortions for SOEs, but are also distortions for instance, foreign operators. And in terms of public procurement, the Philippines have a number of differentiated treatment to foreign parties that make their life more difficult and potentially could violate the implementation of the competitive neutrality principle. So this is also part of the PMR data that I was mentioning before, and what this data actually captures is that there are a number of problems for FDI, for foreign ownership in a number of sectors. You know very well what they are. And there are also discrimination in terms of public procurement against foreign parties. And this is the type of issue that affects the implementation of competitive neutrality. So let me just finish with this. These are broad policy recommendations, this slide and the next. I won't go through both, but the essence of what we have seen through the research on competitive neutrality is that there is not general obligations to actually implement all these blocks that we were discussing, but you have excellent examples in the domestic regulatory framework that can help you implement this block. So it's not about looking abroad or looking at what other countries are doing. Some of the SOEs are doing each of these things. So the idea is, how can we mainstream that experience from the sector at the sectoral level, economy-wide? So thank you very much.